The history of Zambia is something that I've always been really intrigued to learn more about. The long history of Zambia includes evidence of ancient man in the territory. They call it the Broken Hill Kabwe Skull when you type that into Google. This claim can be hard to substantiate without supporting evidence of a civilization. They're just going off of one skull. But the earliest known modern humans to live in the territory known as modern-day Zambia were the Khoisans. The Khoisans is like a catch-all term for any non-Bantu person. And if you don't know what Bantu is, we'll explain that in a little bit. The Khoisans were bushmen. They were brown in complexion, hunter-gatherers who lived a nomadic life with Stone Age technology. So they mainly collected fruit and nuts, but they also hunted antelope and other animals. The Khoisans were the only inhabitants of most of Zambia until the 4th century when the Bantu started to migrate from the north, kind of present-day Nigeria. Well, they had a far more developed technology. They were farmers and had iron and copper tools and weapons, as well as knowledge of pottery making. They lived in small, self-sufficient villages of wattle and dab huts, growing sorghum and beans, as well as keeping cattle and goats. So you see a lot more development in that time. The Tonga live in southern Zambia along the Zambezi River, are the earliest known settlers among the modern ethnic groups. The Tonga are still in Zambia, all down in the Livingstone area. The name Tonga is apparently from a word in the Shona language that means independent. Since the early farmers practiced slash and burn agriculture, they had to constantly move further south when the soil was exhausted. The indigenous Khoisans, well, we're not sure exactly where they went. They were either killed, assimilated into the new culture, or were displaced into areas not suitable for agriculture. With the introduction of agriculture, the population grew and more land became cultivated. By the 11th and 12th centuries, a more advanced society was beginning to emerge. And even though most villages still were self-sufficient, long-distance trade was developing. Copper mining was intensifying, and copper crosses were probably used as currency. Ivory was an export in Zambia, and cotton textiles as an import. The increase in trade resulted in large political units and more complex social structures. So the period between the 16th and 19th centuries saw the emergence of organized Iron Age kingdoms, as well as widespread immigration. Four kingdoms were established in this period. You have the Kazembe Lunda in the north, centered in the Lupala River, the Bemba in the northeast, the Chewa in the east, and the Lozi in the west, centered upon the upper part of the Zambezi River where it originates from. What makes Zambia unique as a territory is that present-day Zambia, being so far inland, did not have direct contact with non-Africans until relatively recently in its history. Arab and Portuguese traders were visiting by the 18th century. The first recorded European visitors to Zambia were the Portuguese, Manuel Catanho Pereira, a trader of mixed Guyanese and Portuguese descent, and in 1796, the Francisco de la Carta, an explorer in 1798. Both came via Tete in Mozambique to Mwata Kazembe's capital to seek the chief's agreements to a Portuguese trade route between their territories of Mozambique and Angola. Lacerda died within a few weeks of arriving at Kazembe's, but left a valuable journal which was carried back to Tete by his priest, which was later translated into English by the explorer Sir Richard Burton. However, it is believed the Portuguese first came in 1720 to Zumba, Mozambique, just across the Luangwa River. The first Briton is probably the most famous Briton and the most famous explorer to Zambia, and that is David Livingstone. In 1851, he started his well-known exploration of the upper Zambezi River, and in 1855, he became the first European to see Moisi Oatunya, the smoke that thunders. Victoria Falls is what it's called today, in honor of Queen Victoria, obviously. The Zambian town near the falls is named after him, Livingstone. Livingstone later died in Zambia in 1873. When the first Europeans arrived, the most powerful states in pre-colonial Zambia were the Kingdom of Barotseland in the upper Zambezi and the Kingdom of Mwata Kazembe on the Lupala. The Lozi people of Barotseland had refused Arab and Portuguese traders access to their territory. When the kingdom was first established is uncertain, but it was certain in existence by the 18th century. The Lozi, calling themselves Aluya, and their country Nguru, Its ruler was called Litunga. He had two capitals. In the dry season, he stayed in the middle of the Zambezi River floodplain, but whenever the rain started, he moved up to a different place out of the floodplain. The first certain historical fact concerning Borotsoland is the arrival in the early 19th century of the Makola, a clan of Southern African Basotho or Swana people, utterly defeated by Shaka's new Zulu kingdom in the 1820s. The remnant of the Makola under the leadership of Sebetwane were forced to march northwards to escape. They conquered the Lozi people and became the aristocracy of Borotsoland. With Sebetwane as new Litunga, Sebetwane proved to be an able leader and is spoken of within warm respect by David Livingstone, who met him in 1851, shortly before his death. He was succeeded by his daughter, Mamochisane, who stepped down early in favor of her half-brother. With him, the Makolo Empire appears to have started to fall to pieces, especially after his death in 1863. A year later, internal dissension in the ruling class brought a revolt by the Lozi people that is said to have exterminated the Makolo aristocracy and forced the survivors to migrate to present-day Malawi. Towards the end of the 19th century, British hunters, then traders, then settlers started to arrive. In 1888, Cecil Rhodes, spearheading the British commercial and political interests in Central Africa, obtained a mineral rights concession from local chiefs. In the same year, Northern and Southern Rhodesia, now Zambia and Zimbabwe, were proclaimed a British sphere of influence or protectorate. In the beginning, the territory was administered by Rhodes and the British South African Trading Company, which showed little interest in the province and used it mainly as a source of labor. The most important factor in the colony's economy was copper, the discovery which is due partly to an American scout, Frederick Russell Burnham, who in 1895 led and oversaw the massive Northern Territories, the BSA, Exploration Company. This expedition, which established that major copper deposits existed in Central Africa, along the Kafue River, in the then Northern Rhodesia, Burnham saw many similarities to copper deposits he had worked in the United States, and he encountered natives wearing copper bracelets. In 1923, the British government decided not to renew the company's charter. As a result, Southern Rhodesia was annexed formally and granted self-government in 1923. After negotiations, the administration of Northern Rhodesia was transferred to the British Colonial Office in 1924 as a protectorate, with Livingstone as capital. The capital was transferred to the more central Lusaka in 1935. A legislative council was established, of which five members were elected by a small European minority, only 4,000 people, but none of the African population. In 1928, enormous copper deposits were discovered in the region, which then became known as the Copper Belt, transforming Northern Rhodesia from a prospective land of colonization for white farmers to a copper exporter. By 1938, the country produced 13% of the world's copper extraction. The sector was developed by two companies, the Anglo-American Corporation and the South African Rhodesian Selection Trust, who controlled the sector until independence. However, the poor safety record and increased taxes triggered a strike of African mine workers in 1935, known as the Copper Belt Strike. The strike was crushed by the authorities. Six miners were killed. And during the Second World War, white miners came out on strike in 1940, realizing the importance of their products for the war. They demanded higher salaries. This strike was followed by another by African mine workers. Even before the war, there had been talks about merging the two Rhodesias, but the process had been halted by British authorities and brought to an absolute stop by the war. Finally, in 1953, both Rhodesias were joined with Nyasaland, now Malawi, to form Central African Federation. Northern Rhodesia was the center of much of the turmoil and crisis that afflicted the Federation in its last years. At the core of the controversy were insistent African demands for greater participation in government and European fears of losing political control. A two-stage election held in October and December 1962 resulted in an African majority in the Legislative Council and an uneasy coalition between the two African nationalist parties. The council passed resolutions calling for Northern Rhodesia's secession from the Federation and demanding full internal self-be under a new constitution and a new national assemblies based on a broader, more democratic franchise. On the 31st December 1963, the Federation was dissolved and Northern Rhodesia became the Republic of Zambia on 24th October 1964, Independence Day. At independence, despite its considerable mineral wealth, Zambia faced major challenges. Domestically, there were few trained and educated Zambians capable of running the government, and the economy was largely dependent on foreign expertise. Most of Zambia's neighboring countries were still colonies or under white minority rule, and the United National Independence Party, UNIP, won the pre-independence elections, gaining 55 of the 75 available seats. The Zambian African National Congress won 10 seats, and the National Progressive Party won all the 10 seats reserved for whites. Kenneth Kaunda was elected prime minister and later that same year president, as the country adopted a presidential system. Kaunda adopted an ideology of African socialism, close to that of Julius in Tanzania. Economic policies focused on central planning and nationalization, and a system of one-party rule was put in place. Now, here's what one-party rule looked like in Zambia. In 1968, Kaunda was re-elected as president, running unopposed, and during the following years, Zambia adopted a one-party system. In 1972, all political parties except UNIP were banned, and this was formalized in a new constitution that was adopted in 1973. The constitution framed a system called one-party participatory democracy, which in practice meant that UNIP became the sole political factor in the country, and it provided for a strong president and a unicameral National Assembly. National policy was formulated by the Central Committee for UNIP, and the cabinet executed the Central Committee's policy. In legislative elections, only candidate running for UNIP were allowed to participate. Even though their inter-party competition was out of the question, the contest for seats within UNIP was energetic. In the presidential elections, the only candidate allowed to run was the one selected as president of UNIP at the party's general conference. In this way, Kaunda was re-elected unopposed with a yes or no vote in 1973, 1978, 1983, in 1988. The economy in Zambia after independence, it was very left-wing in nature, and that means a lot of central planning. Under five-year plans, private companies were nationalized and incorporated into large state-owned conglomerates. So the government's goal was to be self-sufficient, which it sought to achieve through import substitution. At first, the plan worked and the economy grew steadily, but in the mid-1970s, the economy started to decline drastically. During the period between 75 and 90, Zambia's economy dropped by approximately 30%. Now, the reason for this was that Zambia's economy was heavily dependent on the copper industry, which had previously been nationalized, and during the 1970s, the price of copper sank drastically, partly due to the USSR, the second largest producer, flooding the market, and this resulted in a large deficit for the state-owned enterprise. Another reason for the drop was Zambia's involvement in neighboring countries' politics and the transportation problems that resulted, trying to get things out of the continent. To deal with this crisis, Zambia took big loans from the IMF and the World Bank, hoping that copper prices would rise again soon instead of issuing structural reforms. Now, the foreign policy of Zambia sympathies lay with forces opposing colonial and white-dominated rule. During the next decade, it actively supported movements such as the National Union for the Total Independence of Angola under the Independence War, and under the subsequent civil war, the Zimbabwe African People's Union in Southern Rhodesia and the African National Congress in their struggle against the apartheid in the Republic of South Africa. Zambia also hosted some of the movements. For instance, the ANC exile headquarters were in Lusaka, and ZAPU had a military base in Zambia. This resulted in some security problems as South Africa and South Rhodesia raided targets inside Zambia on several occasions. Rhodesian counterinsurgency operations extended into Zambia, and after Zimbabwe's People Revolutionary Army, ZIPRA, rebels shot down two unarmed Vickers Viscount civilian airliners, Air Rhodesia 825 and Air Rhodesia 827. those in 1978 and 1979, respectively, with Soviet-supplied SA-7 heat-seeking missiles. In retaliation for shooting down Flight 825 in September of 1978, the Rhodesian Air Force attacked the Zebra guerrilla base at Westlands Farm near Lusaka in October 1978, warning Zambian forces by radio not to interfere. Conflicts with Rhodesia resulted in the closing of Zambia's borders with that country and severe problems with international transport and power supply. However, the Kariba hydroelectric station on the Zambezi River provided sufficient capacity to satisfy the country's requirements for electricity. A railway to the Tanzania port of Dar es Salaam, built with Chinese assistance, reduced Zambia's dependence on railway line south to South Africa and west through an increasingly war-ravaged Angola. Civil strife in neighboring Mozambique and Angola created large numbers of refugees, and many of them fled to Zambia. Internationally, Zambia was an active member of the Non-Aligned Movement and hosted a summit in Lusaka in 1970. Kenneth Kaunda served as the movement's chairman from 70 to 73. Among the NAM countries, Zambia was especially close to Yugoslavia. Outside the NAM, Zambia also had close relations with the People's Republic of China, and in the Second Congo War, Zambia backed Zimbabwe and the Congo, but did not participate as a belligerent. Kenneth Kaunda has had all of this power, but his rule does come to an end with the movement for multi-party democracy and the end of one-party rule. And the declining economy really created disappointment among the people, and several strikes hit the country in 1981, and the government responded by arresting several union leaders, and among them, Frederick Chaluba. In 86 and 87, protests arose again in Lusaka and on the Copper Belt. Those were followed by riots over rising food prices in 1990, in which at least 30 people were killed. Extensive protests made Kaunda realize the need for reform. He promised a referendum on multi-party democracy and lifted the ban on political parties. This resulted in quick formation of 11 new parties. Among these, the Movement for Multi-Party Democracy, led by former union leader Frederick Chaluba, was the most important. After pressure for the new parties, the referendum was canceled in favor of direct multi-party election. Frederick Chaluba and the MMD, after a new constitution had been drafted, elections were held in 1991, and they were generally regarded to have been free and fair, and Chaluba won 76% of the presidential vote, and the MMD took 125 of the 150 seats in the National Assembly, with UNIP taking the remaining 25. Economically, Chaluba, despite being a former union leader, stood to the right of Kaunda, with support from the IMF and World Bank, to which Zambia was heavily indebted. He liberalized the economy by restricting government's interference, reprivatizing state-owned enterprises such as copper mining, and removing subsidies on various commodities, most notably mealie meal. When one-party rule was abolished in 1991, many expected a more democratic future for Zambia, and these expectations were, however, clouded by the MMD's treatment of the opposition. See more of the same. Questionable amendments of the constitution and detentions of political opponents caused major criticism, and some donor countries, i.e. the UK and Denmark, withdrew their aid. In 1993, the government-owned newspaper The Times Zambia reported a story about a secret UNIP plan to take control of the government by unconstitutional means called the Zero Option Plan. The plan included an industrial unrest, promotion of violence, and organizations of mass protests. UNIP did not deny the existence of such a plan, but underlined that it was not part of their official policy, but the views of extremists within the party. The government responded by declaring a state of emergency and putting 26 people in detention. Of these, seven, including Kenneth Kaunda's son, Wesley Kaunda, were charged with offenses against the security of the state. The rest were released. Prior to the 1996 elections, UNIP formed an alliance with six other opposition parties. Kenneth Kaunda had earlier retired from politics, but after initial turbulence in the party due to the Zero Option Plan scandal, he returned, replacing his own successor. Chaluba's government then amended the constitution, banning people whose parents were not both Zambian citizens from becoming president. This was directly aimed at Kaunda, whose parents were actually born in Malawi. In protest, UNIP and allies boycotted the elections, which were then easily won by Chiluba and the MMT. In 1996, matters escalated again. On 28th October, a coup d'etat attempt took place as a group of army commanders took control of the national radio station, broadcasting ZNBC a message stating that Chiluba was no longer president. The coup was brought to an end by regular forces after Chiluba had again declared a state of emergency. One person was killed during the operation. After the failed coup, the police arrested at least 84 people accused of involvement. Among these were Kenneth Kaunda and Dean, leader of the opposition party, the Zambian Democratic Congress. The arrests were condemned and criticized as illegal inside as well as outside of Zambia, and the accusation of torture were made as well. Kaunda was released in June the following year, but 44 of the soldiers who took part in the coup were sentenced to death in 2003. Prior to the elections of 2001, Chiluba tried to change the constitution to allow him to run for the third term, but he was forced to step back on this point after protests from within the party as well as from the Zambian public. So that's the history of Zambia, some of the more recent history within the past 20 years. I'll do another video on that, but thank you guys for joining this one. This is a Zambian American, Dzaunana.